well. But usually, I think if that is a case, I will plan, probably I won't cover many things because you will leave by 2 p.m., right? So probably I will cover up to probably 2:30, 30 minutes more, for example. So it depends on the condition. So that you won't lose, you won't miss too much thing. Although I recorded, but I also still hope that you won't miss too much thing. Okay, so this is the collection that I have done. Okay, so for four buyers, I think I just mentioned before, four buyers, this is P, this is N, or we say this is anode, this is cathode with the bar, here is the bar. Okay, cathode. So cathode is a negative terminal of diode. Okay, anode is the positive terminal of the diode. Okay, so if positive terminal connect to positive voltage, terminal of multimeter, if you change to ohm means ohmmeter, if you change to voltage means voltmeter. So multimeter means multi, you can select which meter you want. Okay, so positive terminal, usually we use a red wire. Red wire will connect to the anode, black color wire will connect to the cathode. So this kind of a connection we call our forward bias, because we actually forward bias the diode. So up to theoretically, when you reach a 0.7 volt, your diode will be like a short circuit, short means connected. So the current will flow through the diode in one direction. Okay, if you connect like this, this is a reverse bias. Okay, for forward bias, okay, the value, the resistance is actually small. That's why your current can flow through. It's around 1000 ohm to probably up to 10 mega ohm also possible. Okay, so but the voltage, the resistance is very small. Okay, it's a small value. Okay, but reverse bias, is like this. The black color negative terminal connect to positive terminal of the diode, connect to the anode of the diode. The cathode of the diode will connect to the positive terminal of multimeter. Remember that multimeter has the battery, that has the internal battery. Actually, with this connection, we are using the battery supply from the internal battery of multimeter. So for reverse bias, the resistance is actually very high. Sometimes they will show you, if you're using digital multimeter, they will put OL out of the range. They can't show you because too high already. Okay, the resistance. And this needle, please be careful. When you change this scale to ohm meter, usually your needle will be started from left hand side, right? And then they will turn to right hand side if there is a reading. But from ohm meter, it's the ballet, it reverse. Why I say like that? So you don't refer to this needle. Okay, if you're using analog multimeter, means not digital. Okay, usually the needle starting from left hand side, after there's some reading, right, they will go to the needle will be turned to the right hand side, okay, like this. Yeah, they will turn to here. Okay, but if you use ohm meter, let's say you change to ohm meter for the analog multimeter, okay, if the needle is at the left hand side, it is actually referred to infinity. You know what I mean by infinity? Infinity resistance means if the resistance very big, the resistance that you measure very big, the needle has no changes. Okay, if the resistance very small, so that's why I say, here, this one is the needle. It depends on what kind of a multimeter you use. So when you read the multimeter, usually for analog multimeter, the needle, okay, when the value is your reading is high, the needle will be turned from left hand side to right hand side. This is a common multimeter, but some of the multimeter may work differently. But here, usually, the left hand, the needle of your multimeter will turn from left hand side to right hand side for a high reading. But so when the value is very small, this needle actually will go to right hand side. If the resistance value very high, this leader actually will go to left hand side. Okay, so the scale, the reading actually is actually written on the screen of a multimeter, no worry. But I just let you know. Okay, so you have to check when you use ohmmeter, you refer to the ohm reading on your screen. You will realize that the infinity resistance, the infinity resistance will be at the left hand side. And the 0 ohm or 1 ohm, 2 ohm will be on the right hand side. Okay, meaning that in low resistance, your needle will turn to right hand side because 0 ohm, 1 ohm, 2 ohm all will be from the right hand side. Okay, so this is the I just share to you the practical experience for this. I think some of you have used this. I think all of you have used multimeter before. You know what I mean, right? Okay, so we continue to this. Okay, for example, here, this one, we use a resistance. We use a multimeter in your multi-scene to measure the resistance value. So this is a forward bias, right? Because of positive terminal to here, negative terminal of a multimeter to the cathode. So this is actually forward bias. So when forward bias, you can get a resistance reading. And then if you reverse bias means you will change the polarity of the diode. So you will get a higher value, all right? So for germanium diode, okay? So you can't get this germanium diode model in the simulation software. Okay, so we just, we can't do it. But for silicon diode, you can get it. Let's say for example, 1N4001, this is one of the silicon diode models, right? So we do it in the simulation, you get the forward resistance and reverse resistance, and then you calculate the ratio, reverse over forward. By right, your reverse resistance should be a very, very large resistance, which usually out of the range of your physical multimeter during your experiment. But in simulation, they will give you a certain value. For example, I think the value that you got last section, probably this is 8 megahertz, right? This is for the simulation here, this probably will be 2 megahertz. For the experiment part, you just ignore. How do you know? So in your lab report, if I ask you to put in the result, means this one, you can create your own table or you can use back my table, no problem. So you say a table, you draw it, then those blank space, for example, because in this lab, you're not going to do the experiment, right? You do simulation in the software. Last time next round, probably they will do experiment. They won't going to do simulation. So it depends. It depends on the situation. So for your case, you only do simulation. So your experiment part, you just put a dash for the experiment part because you don't get any result from the experiment part. For the simulation part, if you get a result, you put it here. So 2 mega, 4 mega, let's say for example, reverse over forward, you will get a mega over 2 mega, you get the ratio equivalent to 4. Reverse to forward ratio is actually equivalent to 4. So this is what you get from your result, from your simulation. But I didn't tell you that what is this? Why we need to calculate ratio? For example. Okay, so that is the thing that you need to Google, okay, find out what is the theoretical value for reverse to forwards ratio? What is the theoretical value? Okay, is it the ratio that I get 4? Is it correct? Okay, so this is what we mean by discussion on the result. Okay, so if I in the report format, I ask you to put result and the discussion on the result, this is what I mean. The result you get, but what it means. So you have to explain by finding it from Google, and then you explain it. Okay, you understand what I mean? Okay or not? Do you understand?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So the first one we have done. Okay. I think I can show you what I done before. What I have done before. I don't. Actually, I'm okay to show you. Okay. So this is my what I find out from reference book or whatever. So usually for germanium and silicon, theoretically, okay, the value to forward bias to turn on the germanium is the 0.3 volt, but for silicon, the material silicon will be 0.7 volt, theoretically. In practical, it will be less than 0.7 volt. It will less than 0.7 volt because practically there are some, they won't be so perfect. This is when it is perfect. Okay, so theoretically. So the value that I get is actually for multi-spin is 8 mega. Okay, okay, for forward bias for silicon is 2.83. So I would say my ratio is 4. Is it a 4 correct or not? So that's the thing I say, we sometimes I need your discussion. You have to spend your time to find some find out some information on this. But for this case, I just show to you because you don't need to write report on this one. This is lab one only, lab one. So the value of reverse resistance is very large as compared to forward resistance. By right, your reverse one, if you use a physical multimeter to measure, this one should be OL, you know, out of the range. If you use analog, the physical analog multimeter, you will get infinity. They will turn the needle to infinity on. So it's actually infinity. So the ratio of reverse to forward resistance actually is 100,000 to 1. Means 100,000 reverse resistance, it will be equal to 1, you will get 1 ohm for forward resistance. So 100,000 to 1 ratio for silicon diode. For germanium is 40,000 to 1. This is actually an ideal diode's resistance ratio. Okay, so to make sure that reverse resistance must has very large resistance. In conclusion, they just want you to make sure that the reverse bias, when reverse bias, the resistance is very large, and the forward bias, the resistance is smaller, and much more smaller compared to reverse bias. Reverse bias resistance. So this is what they want you to understand. Okay, why? Okay, why? Because of the PN junction, when you connect the two things, the two different types of silicon together. So the depletion region there will cause the resistance differently. Okay, especially when you apply the voltage there. The external voltage when you apply to PN junction connect there, so the PN junction depletion layer will getting wider or getting narrow based on the external voltage that you apply to the diode. Okay, so this is how to test whether the resistance is good or not good. Okay, so then we go to the second one. So this one IV characteristic also we have done before. So basically we put 220 ohm here and then a silicon diode. The model can be any silicon diode. So we put a 1M4001 in our simulation, right? Okay, then we run the simulation for ammeter connect in series, for wattmeter connect in parallel, right? So this is what we had done, right? So this one is DC, this one is AC. So we actually measure DC because this is a DC voltage. So we use a DC measurement of the multimeter. This is for ammeter, this is for wattmeter. Because I put V here, this one, I put A. Okay, then I run the simulation. Okay, I get the value. So I change, keep changing the value 0.1, 0.2, change manually one by one. Okay, manually one by one. After I get 0.1 volt, okay, what is the value I put in here? What is the current value for ammeter? I put here. Resistance you cannot get lah. Resistance you have to calculate V over I. Okay, V over I you get the resistance. Okay, then you change to 0.1 volt. VD, this is VD. VD means the voltage across the diode. This one. Voltage across the diode. But the value that you change is here, no. So from 0 you change to 0.1, you're changing here. When this is 0.1, it doesn't mean that your VD is 0.1 because there is a voltage, the voltage will be split to this resistance as well. But I say that when you put this 0 volt, 0.1 volt, 0.2 volt, let's say I put 0.1 volt, is actually, I assume your the voltage drop across the diode also about 0.1 volt as well. You know why? Because the resistance value that I put here is very small. 220 ohm is very small. So the voltage drop across here also very small. And it can be ignored. Probably, let's say for example, I put 0.5 volt here. Here only will consume. I put 0.5 volt here. Here only probably will have a voltage drop of about 0.01 volt. So here will be 0.499 volt, for example. So that's why more or less, okay, this the voltage drop across the diode will be same as the voltage of your battery, of your power supply. Do you understand what I mean? Understand? Yes. Understand? Okay, you have to give me some. This one we discussed already last week. But because we're going to continue this, so I have to explain to you first. If not, you forget. So I think we stopped here last time. Okay, so we just keep changing the value. Where is it? I forget already. So we keep changing the value. Then I ask you to do the reverse bias. So for the reverse bias part, everything are same. Everything are same, just the polarity of the diode you convert, you invert like this. Okay, you can do it. For those who haven't done, you can just do it. And then you change this value, okay, according to the table. Table say 10, 20, 30, then you change 10, 20, 30. Up to which value? This one, right? So I say compute and record the, not this one. For each diode voltage in table 1.2. So table 1.2 is here. Right? For forward bias voltage, you do this. For reverse bias, you do this. Negative just means the reverse bias. So you just put 5 volt enough. Okay? 5 volt, 10 volt, 12, 15, 20, 25. Why not I continue? Why not I continue? Why I stop at 25? There must be a reason, right? I think you learn this from lecture also. So when you apply the reverse voltage, reverse bias to your diode, there is a breakdown voltage. So the reverse voltage, when you apply, there is only a small current, a small leakage current will flow through the diode, very small. Okay, but when you apply the reverse voltage, there is a limitation. You cannot over a certain reverse voltage. If not, theoretically, it will be around, I think, 50 volt, right? 50 volt. If over 50 volt, what will happen? Your diode will break down. Break down means spoiler, will be short, will be shorted. Okay. How I know this? How I know this is what is this value? How I know what is this value? So you refer to the data sheet. For example, I go to a data sheet. Okay. So this is 1M4001. Okay, I share to you how I read the data sheet. So I look at the reverse voltage. VR is a reverse voltage. So for 1M4001 is the rating is the maximum maximum rating. So it's around 50 volt. Okay, it's around 50 volt. How I get this data sheet? Just like 1M4001. Google it, because the model, it depends on which manufacturer. So the manufacturer I choose is ON Semiconductor. This is a company, so the company come out and then I refer to the data sheet, they say it's but even different company, I would say 95% are same. Okay, 95% of these companies' diodes, the characteristic and the rating usually are same because they are using the same material, silicon. So that's why more or less are same. So 50 volt. So in here, actually, I can ask you to test the reverse voltage up to 50 volt. But I don't do that because this table will also be used by students when they do hardware experiment. So ideally, it should be up to 50 volt. Practically, if you test it, we wouldn't ask you to test up to 50 volt. If up to 50 volt, you will spoil the hardware diode. You know, you will spoil the diode. That's why we will have to replace it every semester if that is the case. That's why we will only ask you to test. We want you to understand during the reverse bias, there is only a small leakage current will flow through the diode. Ideally, it should be no current, you know, but practically, it should be a very small leakage current in microampere. Means that you can ignore it, just microampere. Okay, so up to 25, we will ask you to stop during hardware experiment. But because you are running in simulation, you can actually continue to test up to 50 volt. Because simulation software, you won't spoil the diode. You understand what I mean? So if you want to continue 25, then 30, 35, okay, no problem. You can continue. So you change the value one by one, and after you change the value, you run the simulation, get the value, you fill in the table one by one. This is one method. Okay, the other method I'm going to teach you is this one. This one you know already. So this is real bias, change this one. Okay, and then you change this voltage. Double click. This is DC power. Like battery, DC power. So I just change the value. What value you want to change? No worry, if for those who haven't done this, I will let you do later. Okay, so we go to the DC suite first. DC analysis. So how can I do this? So this is a reverse bias. So if I erase this one, okay. You can open your project later and do it. I just expand first. I will reserve the time for you to do it later. So where's the diode? Okay. So I place never mind. I just okay. So I just erase this one. So let's say I want to test a forward bias. Now I teach you the other method of doing this. Okay, I control R. So this is a forward bias. So I connect like this. Okay, so for example, if I ask you to discuss this in your discussion, you also can discuss why I put 220. Can I put 220 kilo ohm? Can I put this? That's a reason, right? I already explained to you why I use 220, because I want the voltage, almost all the voltage supply for my DC DC power source is actually almost same as the voltage drop across the diode. If you use 220 kilo ohm, what will happen? Because of the voltage divider rules, I think you learned voltage divider rules before, right? Am I right? Have you learned voltage divider rules?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think voltage divider rules. So if this resistance is very big, end up there will be a certain voltage drop across here. So the total voltage will minus this voltage, and then the balance will be the equivalent to the voltage drop across the diode. So end up when I want to have 0.1 voltage drop across the diode, I put here 0.1. Here probably is not 0.1, you know. Then you have to adjust the value one by one yourself until it reach 0.1 volt that you want for the potential across the diode. So this one will waste this like this. It will waste your time, right? That's why I put a small resistance here. For example, this is kind of a discussion. So you can put your discussion on the result, discussion of your simulation, what you actually found or find out yourself. This is your own effort. Okay, so here I put a forward bias here. So then I run the how to run this. You go to simulate and this simulation, you click this one. Okay, then you choose there are many. So we choose usually is at first is interactive simulation. Interactive simulation means when you run, they will give you the real-time value. So when I run, they respond to me immediately on the spot. AC suite means that I run all the value that you set. For example, I go to AC suite, okay, I choose output, okay, which variable. So I want to see the voltage drop across D1, so I choose D1, and then I want to get the current, right, because I want to fill to the table. The table is actually all this current. I want to fill in the I. You don't need a V already here. I want to fill in the I. Okay, so I choose I and I add. Simulate. Okay, and it's so I choose I. It's okay. I will ask you to I wait for you later. So you choose add, then the things will be here. Okay, the thing will be here. Then after that, you go to analysis. parameter. So analysis parameter V1, the source is V1 here. V1, this is one called V1. So what is the value you want to choose? For example, I want to choose what value you want to choose? For example, here I put 80 volt, but now I put 8. What's the value? 0.8 volt, right? So I put 0.8 volt. I just brief you first, and you do later. So okay. So I put 0.8 volt. So here DC. Okay, DC, then output, I got this one already. I want to see this one. The current on the diode one. And here I put 0, here I put stop voltage 0.8 volt. Okay, and then I want to increment for every 0.1 volt. Every 0.1 volt, they will give me a result. Okay, then I save it. Okay, and then I run. You see, they will give me this result. So for 0.1 volt, this will be a result. 0.2 volt, this will be a result. 0.3 volt, this is 0.4, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, 0.8. So they give it. So in your red report, let's say, of course, this one you don't need to prepare red report, but I mean, if your red report, so if this is the every characteristic, then you have to collect the point, the data one by one, you cross, then you connect all the cross point yourself and draw on the graph paper and submit all together in your red report. If I ask you to prepare, but for this lab one, lab session one, you don't need to prepare. So this is the DC switch for the forward bias. So you can see that theoretically, for 0.7 volt, 0.7 volt is here. Yeah, your diode will be turned on, will be shorted, will be connected, and a large current will flow through. But in the simulation, it shows that actually, from 0.0, you see here is a constant, sudden increase a bit, then here they up a lot. So it's around 0.56, right? About 0.6, 0.5, 0.56 around here. Actually, the diode will be turned on and shorted and allow the large current to flow through. This is for forward bias characteristic. Any question before I ask you to do? Any question?
No.
No. Okay. So diode loss up. OL. Okay. Diode loss up when you apply, yes, correct. For the breakdown voltage just now, yes. Diode loss up. If you reach the highest the maximum reverse voltage, which is the breakdown voltage, so your diode breakdown. Okay. So I would like to ask you, any one of you have done this reverse bias for manually for this? Any one of you have done this this experiment for reverse bias? I think all of you have done forward bias, right? Am I right? Manually, using multimeter to measure. Have you done this experiment using this one forward bias? Let's say forward bias diode. You forward bias the diode and then you use a multimeter to measure the value one by one yourself. Okay, have you done this? Anyone haven't?
Manually, real life or simulator?
Sorry? What you mean?
Manually means in the lab?
Manually means like this. Manually means you change the value one by one, like this. Okay, I change to 30, then 40, and then 50. You change one by one.
Yeah.
Automatically means I run this DC switch or analysis. Because you see, I just put this one, right? I just set the meter. Okay, from start value 0, end value 0.8 volt. Okay, then increment every 0.1 volt automatically for me. At the end, you just show me the analysis result. That's it. You understand what I mean? This is called automatic.
Yeah.
Okay, so manually means you change the value, you keep double click, changing the value, run simulation, get the value, then repeat and repeat again with different value. So mainly, I want to check with you. Have you all done the forward bias analysis for the diode manually? Anyone haven't? You just let me know. I can wait for you. Yes.
Uh-huh.
Have you all done Forward bias diode analysis manually?
No, I think.
No, I don't know.
Okay, so like, let's do together. Okay, so I think, yeah, we just do together. I open this one. I think this is where we stopped last time, lab 1.2, okay? Oh, nothing, huh? Okay, so yeah, never mind, we do together.
I don't know why it looks very deep. It has many applications, I also don't know which to use.
Wait, what do you mean?
I don't know how to explain. I sent it to Desmond already in the phone, and he also don't know what's happening.
You mean your software?
Yeah, my software. They got a lot of application like Intel 4 Iro or low pass
filter. Don't touch your hand. Just evaluate the program.
Huh? Evaluation.
Don't open folder, just evaluate the program that run automatically.
Hey, I have to open only can evaluate, you know.
No, just evaluate lah, then they run.
You mean yes. Just multi-sync, is it? So let's see. Okay, I close my multi-sync. Okay, multi-sync, right? So when I click
I don't have the application. My application is not like that. My application, but yeah, it has the same icon, but its name is not multi-sim. It's like a lot of unusual, what you say, the
features, package. So do you have, can you select this multi-sim?
No, they don't have the name application for
what,
it.
What you have?
Activation, right?
Now I already open is Intel 4 I routed.
I think you installed the wrong
I downloaded the same page as the others. But then it's multi-sim, it's just that it's very weird.
Sure, I think pause the recording, sure.
Yes?
Pause the recording.
Okay, okay, you share your screen, I see.
Share my screen, okay. Mine is like this one.
Where is your screen? You are presenting, so I stop presenting. Okay, yeah, you share your screen, I see.
Mine is from this one is called Circuit Design Suite something, and then I go in and then I forgot which one I press.
Have you shared your screen?
Yeah, I shared already.
You did not share.
I shared already.
You're not sharing.
Share.
I think you
click the screen and then say open it, share the screen.
Present now, you click present now, okay, you click present now button, your entire screen, you click entire screen, then you have to click one more time, click one more time the screen, then you click share.
They don't let me to choose the share thing.
Do you use
okay lady, I know already. So mine is from the National Instrument, and then I go in here and I go in sample, because only sample got, because the others like this one. So I go in sample, and then there's a lot of this multi-sim.
This is a sample project.
But I don't have the one that you have.
I think Chuping, I think
can you search?
Can, yes.
Can you search?
Chuping, you didn't run the installer, Chuping. You didn't run the exe.
You haven't installed.
Yeah, you haven't installed the exe, Chuping. You
only installed the license. Go away.
Where's the file? Go to your Chrome.
My Chrome. Your Chrome.
Where you install?
Yeah,
go to your downloads. Your downloads. Your history. The three button on top right corner.
No. I download from. Wait.
Okay, that button download, you see or not?
Yeah, I download this one.
Okay. The download file where you download after you download, where is it? You show me the download folder, you go to the download file.
This one.
Wait, which one? This one.
Yeah.
And you double click
this one.
And you double click the 14.2 package.
When I download it, it let me download this one first, and then I have to come here and then download this one. 14.2.
Okay. You
so select download, and then it came out this one.
Okay, I think Chuping, we discussed after class. Yeah, do you have class after this 2 p.m. After 3 p.m.
After 3 p.m.
I show you one. I share the video how
thank
I download, then you refer to it. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So we continue our one. I think probably I show you one more time later. So we just continue our screen. Okay. So I just click evaluation. So I open my project first. This is the first project. Lab 1, 1.1 we have done before. So I think I stop here. I think I go through one by one. So I stop here. I run this simulation. This is actually to have I recorded? Yes. Okay. So I think all of you can see this, right? So I've just run my simulation. I can see this value for forward bias, it is 2.8. For reverse bias, it is 8.04. So the reason I put these two together is because I don't want to keep so many files there. So I just keep all the circuit, the two circuit together on a single project file. That's why you see the value here. When I run the simulation, both circuit will be run at the same time. And I use interactive, so they will show me directly on the spot what is the value there. So by right, this reverse bias of the value should be very big. It's not 8.4 megahertz. But because in simulation, they will put a certain value for you. They will put a certain value for you. But in practical experiment, okay, the value will be very big. If you use digital multimeter, it will be OL. If you use analog multimeter, it will be, as an ohm meter, it will be infinity. It will be infinity resistance. So the day we have done this one, may I know anyone haven't done this before? Anyone of you haven't done this before? Can you tell me?
I just installed multi-sim. My thing can do
that.
I just installed multi-sim last week.
Because
online.
So that's why I say please install your multi-sim first. If you have any question, you just let me know. Or just now I think Chuping has a problem. Chuping has problem. So by right, after you install, you will get the multi-sim like what I did now, what I show you here. Okay, but I'm not sure why you can't install. Chuping, have you used the multi-sim before?
No, never.
Oh, okay, never mind. I try to get the video how to download and install to you. I will upload to the Google Classroom later. But you just listen first, because this is just simple only. Okay, just like this.
Alright.
Okay, so I think should be no problem for those who just install and you want to do it, should be no problem. Okay, so we go to the second one. Second one is I closed, I opened this one. So the lab 2, lab 1.2, this one. Okay, I just opened this one. So there's nothing here, nothing here. So I want to do the diode characteristic, right? So I can go to place, okay, again, right? Come, we do together for those who have this one. So resistor, we choose what thing you want, what is the thing that you want to find, diode. So let's say I want to choose 1N4001. Okay, so I place here. And what else, resistor? Resistor is just a, I can put here, yes, resistor. Where is it? It's not diode. Basic resistor. I see resistor here. So 220, right? 220 ohm. 220 ohm. I put here. Okay, what else? Any other? I look at the manual. Any other thing that you want to find? This is what DC power. Okay, DC power. So you just search DC power. This is a source, right? Source. So power source.
Resistor. Which one? I got a lot of resistors.
Yeah, that's why. Another matter. You see, okay, good question. So I place the component. I choose the basic. Click basic. Then you choose resistor. There are so many resistors here. So I want to choose 220. 220? This is 220K. This is 220. This is 220 milli. If let's say I choose the wrong value, doesn't matter. You can double click and change the value here. Because I'm lazy to change the value later. That's why I straight away choose 220. If the library does not provide you 220, doesn't matter, you just simply choose, as long as register, you choose a resistor, then you double click to change the value. Okay, so I highlight this one, left click, highlight this one, I can control R, you change the polarity, control R. Control R means that you click the control and click the R key on your keyboard, control R like this. Right, so I want to, for all bios, I select like this. Highlight, I move this one here, and highlight, I move this one here, this one should be here, right? I just connect according to my circuit diagram. Control R, so I put here, and move here. Right, so I want to do this, so I want to do this one, I choose my manual, where is my manual? Okay, I choose my manual. Okay, I think we do together. So this one, positive terminal is a longer one, negative terminal is a shorter one. So I connect like this, I connect to, right, which is then I need multimeter, right? Multimeter. So where to get multimeter? Here. If you can't get a multimeter here, you can't get a multimeter here. This is point to here, they will show you multimeter. I click, then I place. If you can't get this, you can go to simulation there. Tools, right? Okay, so it's somewhere hiding here. I forget which one. If not, basically it's 2 or simulate. Okay, you can still get the multimeter there. Because some of the version, some of the multi-sim version, they actually didn't list down all the instruments here. These are called instrument for you to measure things, right? So here, this is the thing. So I put...
Can you get the multimeter,
yeah.
From the top, right?
Yeah.
The multimeter, it's not where you pull down.
Yeah, I click. Can you see?
Oh,
right hand side. You point to here, you see multimeter, the words. The we call balloon, the balloon will show you multimeter. So you click and you place here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, but some of the version they didn't list down the instrument on your right hand side, on your rightmost boundary here. Sometimes they didn't put here. So you have to go to simulate, you choose because there are so many versions, you know. So different version, they actually put the instrument in different tab. Sometimes they put in simulate, sometimes they put in tools, right? So I don't know which version you use, but that's why yeah, you just go and go around, you will see the multimeter name there. The tools is inside, sometimes hiding here only. Okay, so then I connect in series with this, because this multimeter, I double click, I'm going to make it become ammeter. I'm going to set as ammeter, wattmeter, or ohmmeter, right? I say it as ammeter because I want to measure the current flow through the diode. I want to study the I and V characteristic of diode. Okay, then here I connect, and I connect here, then I connect to, yeah, that's it. Right, and I need a ground, right? I need a ground. So how to get ground? Place, okay, component, get ground. Ground is also a source. So I choose here, group, source. Where's the source? Ground. Sana, ground. Okay, then I click, okay, I place here. So ground is connected. And then I want to get the other multimeter. I go to here, okay, multimeter, I control R. Multimeter will be placed here. So I connect positive terminal to here, negative terminal to here. Okay, then by default, the simulation mode that set is interactive. Meaning that when I run the simulation, they will straight away get the real-time on the spot value to you, to me. Okay, so I just double click this one, make sure this is voltage, DC voltage, because DC, this one DC, DC and direct current. So this one also, I double click DC, okay, I run the simulation. So I double click, they give me, the value is 51.24. Okay, this one is 700. So I want to change this value. I don't want 12 volt. I want, what value you want to do? 0 volt, right? If I put 0 volt or 0, yeah, it's running. So 0, okay. 0 volt, okay. Then I run 0. Right? Then you record here. Okay, this is 0, 0. Right? This is 0, 0. This is ammeter 1, 1. Ammeter, this is multimeter 2. So 0, 1. So what I mean manually is like this. So I check this table. So it's from 0 and I fill in. So what's the value you fill in here? So 0, 0. So now the VD is, then I stop. Now the VD diode is 0.1 volt. So I change here. So 0.1 volt, 0.1. And I click OK. And then I run the simulation 0.1. So I will get the current actually is equivalent to 0.08868 microampere. Nano, this is nano. If convert to micro, it will be move 1, 2, 3 tension microampere. So here you don't need to put milli. If you want to fix as milli, then you convert to milli. Here you can, this table is just for your reference. You want to draw your own label, your own table can, no problem. This is for your reference. So if you want to use, you can use. If you want to use, you want to do some correction here, can, no problem. Okay, sometimes people just I don't want to put milliampere. If I want milliampere, I insist 1 milliampere, can, no problem. You know why I insist want to put milliampere? Because later when you draw the graph, the IV characteristic graph, you will, if I put the scale in milliampere, you will see that the current actually is zero, because in milliampere is if you convert this value to milliampere, it's actually zero ampere, right? This current is too small. So it's actually, that's the reason I put milliampere. So I have a reason. So when you do your graph, I will only follow milliampere. So this is zero. For milliampere, it is zero. For nanoampere, there are some value here. Okay, so in milliampere, zero. I put zero. Okay, then here voltage, 0.1 volt. I adjust 0.1 volt here. This is 0.9998 volt, which is actually, this is 99 millivolt, right? 99.98 millivolt is actually about 0.1 volt. That's the reason I put a small resistor here. So that there are not much voltage drop across this resistor. I would say the voltage drop across this resistance can be ignored, because I still get my diode resistance almost same as the power source voltage. Okay, so in terms of voltage, this one, if I round off, it is actually 0.1. So I want to change to 0.2. So I stop the simulation, double click, change 0.2. This is, I'm change manually one by one. Now 0.2, you see, so I run the simulation. So I get this 815, still in nanoampere. So in milliampere, it's about zero. Right, it's about zero. Okay, so I stop and then I change again and again and again. Okay, have you done this forward bias for all from 0 to 0.8 volt manually? Manually means you change the value one by one yourself in the simulation. Have you done this? Anyone haven't? Please let me know. If not, I will just proceed. Have you done this?
No.
No. No, okay, yeah, you do it first. I wait for 5 minutes. This is manually, manually change it. Yeah, you do it first.
So we need to fill in one by one from zero to zero.
Yes.
And then when we choose the emitter and voltmeter right from the multimeter, we don't need to press set, right? Just press A and then right.
Yes. Okay, you're right. Okay.
Because
so
that is now.
You just double click this one. You don't need to set this one, don't need to set. You just choose emitter, voltmeter, or ohmmeter, because multi, multi means multi-purpose. Okay, so I choose ammeter. And then this is DC, this is AC. So I choose, of course, this one DC only, right? Okay. So you put left-hand side here, left screen with the simulate, and this is called multi-sim. Then right side, you put your report in the Microsoft Word version, for example. You can actually draw the table yourself, or you can actually cut and paste there and then put the value here, no problem. You want to, when you submit the report to me, you must submit a soft copy to me. I will let you know everything. I will let you know. I will put the instruction, everything in my report, red report format. But for lab one, don't need. Lab one, don't need. This is lab one, don't need. Okay, so when you submit the soft copy report to me, okay, so you put your word, your file in the word file. So sometimes students say, so I draw the graph, later I get all this value, right? I draw the graph in the graph paper, but how can I put in the word file? You can take a photo, right? You can take a photo, use your smartphone, take a photo and insert as a picture to your Microsoft Word document before you send your red report to me. Right, you can do it there. That way, no problem.
So if we don't use the graph paper, you can use the graph paper from tablet, can sir?
What the graph paper? What?
From the tablet, the online graph paper.
Oh, can. As I don't care how you draw your graph. As long as you draw it based on the result, I don't want you just go Google and get the graph and then paste to me. You understand what I mean? You, as long as the graph drawn by you, you can use your apps. You can use apps to draw and then insert as the picture also can, no problem. You want to use a handwriting to draw the graph on the physical graph paper and then take a photo, insert as a photo, insert as a picture to your Microsoft Word document also can, no problem. I don't care. As long as you draw it based on your experiment, or in this case, we call based on your simulation result. Okay, so you probably Okay, all the data here. Resistance, you calculate yourself. Resistance, you know, V over I is the resistance. This is for forward bias. Anyone haven't completed this one? Very easy only, this one. Done. Cosrep, are you here? Jali?
Yeah, okay.
I thought you want to attend the student dialogue already, right?
Yeah.
It's okay. Yeah. I will record down this. I will record this.
Okay.
No problem. Jali, are you still here? No, okay. Okay. So next time, yeah, probably he can actually ask the program leader to change to the other time. If you have class, you can actually tell your program leader, just inform Charlie that he can actually tell the program leader to fix the student dialogue time in other time, if he has class. Okay, but no worry, I will still record this down. Okay, so anyone still haven't done this for power bias? Yes?
The voltage to find the resistance, you use the voltage from the diode or the source.
The voltage? This is VD, V stand for diode.
Oh.
Okay.
Then the voltage from the multimeter?
This is measure. I measure. You understand? So when I adjust, let's say I want 0.2 volt, this is actually, this voltage 0.2 volt is actually the voltage across the diode, VD across the. Actually, I want to see when I apply 0.2 volt for the diode, what is the current will flow through the diode? This is what I want to do. But how you apply 0.2 volt to the diode? You need to connect with the battery, right?
Oh, yes.
Now, when you connect a battery, you will have a resistance here. Because you need sometimes limit the current, right? Or the wire that you connect to the diode also, it has the resistance, the parasite inside the resistance is inside the wire. You do one, but it's there. As long as you connect with the wire have resistance. Am I right?
Mm.
So we assume that this resistance is very small. It's about, let's say 200 ohm or 220 ohm, for example. Okay, 220 ohm. So when I adjust this, I want 0.2 volt across the diode. I adjust the voltage here 0.2 volt. Actually, the diode, the voltage across the diode is not 0.2 volt, because some of the voltage will be split. Will lost to here. Will split to here. That's why this resistance value must be very, very small. I put 220, end up, you will see that the voltage across the diode is actually 199.821 milliwatt. So if I say in voltage, it will be around 0.2 volt, actually, Sam. So I will say the voltage drop across resistor 1 can be ignored.
Okay.
So that's why sometimes when you do the experiment, in the hardware experiment also, you will wonder, how come when I supply 0.2 volt, the voltage across the diode is not 0.2 volt exactly? Because some of the voltage actually drop across the resistor, internal resistor in the wire already. Okay. Any other question you want to ask? No, have you completed? Anyone haven't completed the forward bias part? No? Yes? Okay, so we go to reverse bias. You're done already, so we go to reverse bias. Okay, reverse bias is also very easy only. I just increase this one, I close this one, close this one. What I need to do? Right, Chris. So you just escape, if you kiss, if they say the symbol keeps showing like you like this, you just escape. You click escape key on your keyboard, click escape. You will see the arrow here. Arrow, you select this one, delete. Okay, then select this one, delete. Select this one, delete. Escape. Select this one, delete. Right. So now I highlight this one, left click, and then highlight this one. Control R. Reverse bias. Because this positive and longer side is a positive terminal of the battery. Connect to the cathode now. So I connect like this. Okay. Sorry. I draw a better diagram. Okay. Then this one, I connect like this. I connect like this. So this is for reverse bias. Reverse bias. So what is the voltage I want? 0 volt. So I double click. 0 volt. Okay. This is DC power. DC. Then I run my simulation. Okay, I get this double click, I get 0 volt is here, right? 0 ampere, 0 volt. So first one, 0, 0. The second one, 5 volt, I stop, action, double click, 5 volt, 5. Then I click, okay. So I run the simulation, I get, what is the micro ampere? It's 0.17. 0.017. Right? In microampere, it will be here. When this is on 5 volt, it will be 0.017 microampere. Right? So if I change to 10 volt, again, I think you know why I change here 10 volt, it will be equivalent to the 10 volt across the diode. Because the voltage across here is actually very small, you can just ignore. That's the thing. So I stop here, I change this one to not 5 volt anymore, I change to what is the value? 10 volt. Then, okay, this time it's 0.017. So I run, now it's not 0.017, it's 0.022. Still very small, microampere, 0.022. Then I get all this value done until 25. Up to 25, okay, let's say I change the value to 25. Okay, so I run this value, okay, 0.037, still very small, right? Okay, until you put this as a 25 voltage drop, 25 volt, you supply 25 volt, the current this is actually but ideally it should be 0 ampere, But because there is a small leakage current will flow out from the N junction. Okay, that's why the cost when the electron flow out from the N junction to the battery, it will cause the small leakage current to flow through the diode. So when I up to 25 reverse voltage, it still have reverse bias voltage, it still have around 0.037 microampere, which is still very small. Meaning that at this moment, this reverse voltage 25 volt, reverse voltage, when you apply reverse bias up to 25 volt, your diode haven't break down yet, haven't been spoiled yet, because still small current. Ideally, it should be no current or a very, very small leakage current. So it still fulfills the theory. So meaning that your diode still okay. So that's why when we ask you to test for the reverse bias, we only ask you to test until 25. We won't ask you to test until 100, you know. Why? Because we know from the data sheet, just now, data sheet from ON Semiconductor company, because the PIC, the diode model that we buy is actually from ON Semiconductor, for example. So that's why I download this data sheet. So they tell me that VR reverse voltage is actually up to maximum up to 50 volt. So when we ask you to do, we won't ask you to do 50 volt. You ask you to do 50 volt, you will break down our diode. Then I have to replace every semester. 20 student, 20 diode breakdown. You get what I mean? That's why I put 25. But now simulation, you can continue. 25, you continue. 30, 35, up to the voltage, up to the reverse voltage that can break down your diode. How you know that voltage can break down the diode? Your current will suddenly change from nanoampere to microampere. Oh, you understand what I mean? Suddenly increase. You know, nano to micro is actually a bit different. Nano is 10 to the power of negative 9. Micro is 10 to the power of negative 6. So when they suddenly change to microampere, means that the current suddenly increase a lot, means your diode breakdown already, shorted, breakdown already. That's why your current can flow, can suddenly increase dramatically, right? Or significantly. Any question? Anyone haven't done the reverse bias?
Sir, from nano to milli. If nano break it down.
Oh, okay. Possible. It's possible. It's possible. I mean, at least microampere. So if I insist one microampere, it will change nano, milliampere to microampere, it will be 1000 microampere, am I right?
Yeah.
So you will see the current suddenly in microampere scale, it will suddenly from 0.022, 0.037, suddenly change to 1000 microampere, which is the milliampere, 1000 microampere, suddenly increase a lot. At that moment, your diode actually break down already. So based on the point that you got from this simulation 1, 2, 2, there are so many points here. So on the same graph paper, so you plot the graph. How to plot? You plot, you will get the graph characteristic something like this. Then up. This is for forward bias. Then for reverse bias, or sometimes no current, right? Okay, if you are using microampere here, microampere, you see, microampere, actually is almost 0.022, 0.033, 0.037, wow, very small. So suddenly increase 1000 ampere here, just said 1000 microampere here. So suddenly, you need to cross the cross point here, suddenly there, then you connect the cross point freehand drawing. So this is the reverse bias part. This is forward bias part. This is reverse bias. The leakage current is around, theoretically, the leakage current is around 20 milliampere. Not 20 milliampere, breakdown current, okay? It's 20 milliampere. Breakdown. Okay? And then for germanium is 50 milliampere. So this is a breakdown. When breakdown, your high current will flow through. Before breakdown, it is almost 0 microampere. After breakdown, it will be like this. So what is the breakdown voltage here? It's around, theoretically, according to the data sheet. The data sheet means the user manual of the diode is around 50 watt. But I think practically, in the real experiment, it will be less than 50 watt. I think probably just 35 watt, then breakdown already. So that's why we wouldn't ask you to test 50 watt during the real experiment. Okay, so you dot cross the point, then you connect the point, you will get the graph something like this. For silicon, germanium also same. Just germanium is theoretically, because I can only brief you theory, because we can't get this germanium model in the software. That's why theoretically is 0.3, silicon is 0.7. Okay, but just now we see that actually your silicon diode is 0.56, they already turned on. Later I show you. Later I show you. Okay, then this one for germanium, the worst current is 50 milliampere, but for silicon is 20 milliampere when they break down. After breakdown, this is the reverse current. So this is the manual way. So for have you done this forward and bias manual way? Yes, So then we go to automatic way. So automatic way, I won't going to use this one. I don't need to use this one. So I just copy, let's say I copy, I paste here. I lazy to find the other set. So I just paste here. At this moment, I don't going to use this one. I don't need it. Right? So this one, I just reverse. Okay, just forward bias. Now I want to do the forward bias. I want to do a forward bias for my diode. But I don't want to use multimeter to measure manually. Okay, so what can I do? Just now I show you already. So I go to like this, I get back the same thing. This is the second option. You choose yourself which option you want. I do this thing, then I go to simulate. Analysis and simulation. Sometimes if you use a different version, a multi-sim different version, you may have analyst only. You don't have simulation, you only have analyst. The words called analyst here. Same, they are same. As long as when you click here, okay, you will see this thing. Okay, so by default it's interactive simulation, but now I'm going to measure D2. I want to see D2, so I go to DC strip. Okay, DC strip, and then my source is V2. Of course, you know why V2? Because this diagram, I wasn't going to use the diagram just now. I'm actually using the second diagram, this one. So my source is V2, so source V2. if you want to use the first diagram, then you choose V1. But now I redraw the diagram because I want to see the DC street analysis here. Okay, I choose V2. And then my output, output means result. I want to see a result across D2. What result I want to see? Current, right? Current stand for I. I don't need to see V. V, you adjust yourself. Current, D2. Not D1. This is D2, right? D2. So D2. I choose D2. At the output here, I put at, you will see D2 here. For the current output, I want to see the current output. Understand? Can you follow?
Yes.
Yes. Then we go to analysis parameter. Click analysis parameter. Okay. So now I want to forward bias. According to the table given in the manual, is from 0 to 0.1, 0.8. So 0.8. Why I put up to 0.8? Because I know 0.7, your diode confirmed turned on already. So that's why I put 0.8 is more than enough. Right, I won't put 0.4. 0.4, your diode haven't been turned on, so the increment is 0.1. Every 0.1, they will give me a result. So I set, then I run. You see, they give me okay 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4. They give me the result. Then you see the diode here haven't turned on. That's why no current. Suddenly, okay, up to here 0.56. Turn on already, the current increased dramatically. Theoretically, this line should be extended up to here 0.7, then only they up, you know. But this is ideally, in theory, but practically, especially like in a simulation as well, they actually set the value same as the practical value. Usually, it will be less than 0.7 volt. 0.7 volt is the theoretical value to turn on the diode, but practically is around 0.56. You see 0.5 here, they start increase already. Some people say, so can I say 0.5 volt it turn on? Yes, you can say like that, no problem. Okay, about 0.5 to 0.56 here, they actually turn on. That's why the current suddenly increase a lot. So like this, you may ask, so then like this, do I need to draw a graph? They draw for you already. So manually you have to draw yourself. But if automatically using the suite analysis, they actually draw for you. You can see the characteristic already. You don't need to draw yourself. You don't need to draw on the graph paper, then only you realize how is the characteristic. They already show you the characteristic. Okay, so if in the report, if you want to put this also can, no problem. You want to put both also can, no problem. One is manually you get, then you plot. The other one you get from the DC suite analysis report. But of course, in this example, in this lab, you do need to submit that report. This is for forward. Okay? I close it, then I do reverse. So how to do reverse? Just delete this one. And reverse the slide. Okay, click, connect, click, connect. So now reverse. Okay, so the reverse how? I click this one, DCC, I click, I change the value. My version, it allowed me to change the value like this. You see, I click this one, DCC, I click one time, it will prompt out this for me to change the value. But different version may different. So if no, you don't have such a convenient way, you can go to simulate and simulation. Do it one more time. Yeah. Okay, so I change the value now. So it's from what voltage? 0 to store voltage 50 or 60 or 70 or 80. In your manual, I actually ask you to put until 25. But actually, I can put until 80 because simulation, no worry. But practically, in the experiment, don't do 80 volt. 80 volt, I worry you will see the smoke come out from the diode, you know. Okay? Because the high current flow through after the break, your diode will very hot and you will see the smoke come out sometimes. Okay, so 80 volt, and then what's the increment? Every 5 volt, right? You look at the table, it's every 5 volt, right? Every 5 volt, they increase. Okay, I can put 70 also, no problem. 70, 80, 70, 80, okay. SF. Then I run. You see, this is the reverse bias. So when you put 0, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, you see, no current. Okay, in milliampere, milliampere actually no current, because the current is actually in nanoampere, right? It's very, very small. So up to 50, see, 50, breakdown. Here, breakdown, high current flow. So you can see 50 volt is actually the breakdown voltage already. The reverse voltage up to maximum 50. This is the theoretical value stated in the data sheet. Practically, maybe 35 already breakdown. Any question for this?
No.
So how some student will ask, so how, why the graph like this, why that graph like that? Because you need to invert, you know what I mean? Because this one, if I combine the forward bias and the reverse bias graph together on a single graph, of course it will be look like this, because this will be 0, 5, negative 5, negative 10, negative 15, negative 20, negative 25, right? So if you combine, you will actually invert, mirror this thing. You mirror this graph, so the graph at the reverse bias region, reverse bias region. So the graph will be like this. You understand what I mean? If I combine this part and the forward part, forward bias and the reverse bias in a single graph, it will be like the theoretical graph already. Any question before I proceed?
I don't think so.
Okay. So let me check. Okay, no question. So no question. All of you can follow, right? Okay. So we can have some discussion on this. So you see, sometimes in your lab manual, I will put in this item for discussion. So this is also sometimes after you discuss the result and discuss why, let's say, for example, why I put this 220 on here. There's a reason, right? Why I put this. Okay, after you discuss on the result and the simulation, okay, you can have some extra discussion on this part. For example, the first question I asked, what's the relationship of the diode's resistance with the bias condition? You know why? What is the question asking? How can you answer this? How can you answer this?
Hello, sir.
Yes. Who is speaking?
Don't know. There's a few messages in the chat. I think Raymond say no also.
Raymond say no. So what do you mean? What do you mean?
Don't know how to answer that question.
Oh,
understand the question.
Don't answer the question. Okay. So they comment the relationship of the diode resistance. So what is the relationship between the diode resistance and the bias condition? So how many conditions you have in the biasing? Forward bias or reverse bias? So if I ask you to explain the relationship, you can just explain. Okay, the diode will have a higher or large resistance when it is reverse bias. So you explain really the relationship. The diode will have lower resistance when the diode is forward bias, or when the diode is connected in a forward bias connection. So this is the relationship between resistance and biasing condition. There are two biasing conditions, forward bias or reverse bias. Understand?
Understood.
Okay, how about question two? Question two? Does the diode permit the current to flow through it in both directions?
No.
No. Okay. diode only allow the current to flow in one direction when it is forward bias. Yes. Okay. For reverse bias, diode does not allow the current, okay, to flow. But however, there is a very, very small leakage current will flow through the diode when it is reverse bias practically. Theoretically, it shouldn't have any current to flow through when it is reverse bias. You understand? Huh? You can explain like this. By right, they only allowed to both flow in when it is forward bias. When reverse bias, no current can be flow through the diode by right. But practically, there is a small leakage current to flow through the diode when it is reverse bias. But it's a very, very small leakage current, practically. Yeah. Okay, what is the direction of current flow through a diode? From direction from anode to cathode. Okay, so what is the direction of current flow through a diode? From anode, from the anode of diode to the cathode of diode. And you can draw the symbol, you know where is the anode, where is the cathode, right? Then you draw an arrow to show the current flow. Okay, you can do something like this. Okay, this one. Okay, you can draw something like this. Right, you can draw something like this. Okay, I have this. This is positive, this is negative, or this is anode, this is cathode. Okay, cathode. Yeah, sorry, and this one I don't get used. Cathode, right? This is anode. You can do something like this. So the current flow. This is I. It's not electron. I. Okay, from positive to negative diode. Right, from anode to cathode. From anode to cathode. Okay, you can draw something like this, and then you explain. Okay, the condition for silicon and diode to turn on. So what is the condition for silicon to turn on?
0.7 volt.
Yes, 0.7 volt. Germanium.
0.3.
Theoretically, practically, based on my, you can further explain. So item for discussion is related to your experiment. So you can say, however, in my simulation, okay, the diode actually turned on at about 0.56 volt, right? But Germanium, you don't need to discuss because you don't have that model to run in the simulation. So you can see, however, in my practical, I got this 0.5 to 0.56 volt to turn on the silicon diode. Okay, that is your practical output, practical your effort. Understand or not?
Yes.
Okay, any question? Any question? Yes?
Do you mind to explain the number one again? It's not, I lagged out.
I can't hear you. Can you just speak slowly?
Just now, I lagged out for number one. Can you explain number one again? The relationship.
Okay. So the relationship of the diode resistance with the bias condition. So what are the bias conditions that means? Bias condition, you only have two bias condition. One is forward bias. The other one is reverse bias. So what's the relationship between the resistance and the biasing condition? So we will say to explain this one, the first one you can say, okay, when the diode is forward bias, okay, the resistance is, the diode's resistance is low. The diode resistance is high when the diode is reverse bias. So you already explained the relationship. Okay, this is when we test using the ohm meter to measure. So the resistance of the diode is high when the diode is reverse biased. The resistance of diode is low when it is forward biased. So this is the relationship between the resistance and the biasing condition. Don't need to submit red report, but I just tell you. So this is what I say, item for discussion. After discuss result, then you can further discuss this thing. Of course, you can put other discussion that you found from internet or from reference books after you very. After you check, okay, you understand already, you also can put extra discussion in your report. Okay, but for this, lab one, don't need. Okay, too easy already. Okay, any question before I proceed? No worry, I know we run out of time, but for experiment two, I will not I will not ask you to do a lot of things here, but I will do some discussion first for experiment two.
Do you have can you repeat the question three, the answer for it?
Okay, so for question three, the condition for silicon and germanium diode to turn on. So yeah, you just right. Okay, I will say, okay, the forward bias, voltage to turn on silicon diode is 0.7 volt. Okay, I can say, I will say this, yeah, theoretically, in theory, the forward bias voltage to turn on the forward bias voltage to turn on silicon diode is 0.7 volt, and for germanium diode is 0.3 volt theoretically. However, during simulation, the forward bias voltage to turn on, okay, the silicon diode is about 0.5 volt to 0.56 volt. Okay.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Understand, huh? What do you mean, my nice? What do you mean, Raymond? Nothing, huh? Okay. Okay, yeah. Okay, so I think should be no problem already on this one. So any question you want to ask before I explain, I will only brief you halfway first, halfway. But I won't I think we don't have enough time to complete the experiment because since some of you still have problem to install the what you call SIM, multi-SIM. So I will let you to install the multi-SIM. Please install before my next practical session. Okay, so any question? No? So we will proceed to the next experiment, experiment two. So experiment two, we were going to do a half wave and full wave rectifier. As I told you before during my first practical session, why we need to learn diode? Because diode has many functions. Diode has many functions. Okay, we can use it, the first function, we can use it as a rectifier. So what is a rectifier? Rectifier means you convert AC to DC. AC means alternating current, DC means direct current. So for all our home appliances, like your microwave oven, your rice cooker, all actually running in DC. Your work can only be done by your home appliance in DC, not AC. Now my question is, then why the current need to be in AC form? Can you explain to me why? When I learned this last time, I also wonder why, if let's say all our home appliance are actually running the current in DC, direct current format form, DC waveform, why in the world we still have AC waveform? Why?
Can travel long distance.
Yes. Yes, good explanation. Because from our power stations, the current, when they want to supply the current to us, if you run DC, okay, if you run in DC form, what will happen? The wire that deliver the current to your house is very long, you know. So when you run in DC, that DC current will actually dissipate heat. Some of the current will be converted to heat energy. At the end, when the voltage and when the current reach your home, you actually waste some of the current when they are delivering to you. When they are delivered to you and halfway before you reach your house, okay, some of the current actually dissipated as a heat energy only. So it is not energy effective. Okay, that's the reason we change to AC when we want to deliver from the main, from the electric power station, we change to DC first. Okay, because when the DC is delivered from the power station to your house, if it is in AC form, okay, the AC voltage, okay, the AC current that will dissipate the will be changed to the heat energy is actually lesser compared to DC. Okay, because the AC voltage, okay, if you want to know what is the current of AC that actually produce the heat energy, you have to convert your AC to RMS, root mean square, RMS. Have you heard this before? VRMS.
Yes.
Yes, because the VRMS actually is the effective, or we would say is the real current that actually do the work. So if let's say if my AC voltage is 240 volt, let's say the real voltage that produce the heat is not 240 volt. It's actually will be less than that because we actually count the current that produce the heat based on IRMS. IRMS is from VRMS. Okay. So that is the reason we actually use the AC to deliver the current from power station to our house. Okay. So electric power from the main is actually AC due to this method is more efficient and economic than the DC distribution. So the rectifier is actually to convert AC to DC. So usually the rectifier will be in front of your home appliance. For example, your smartphone charger is not just a USB cable, right? There's another power adapter, right? That adapter, inside the adapter, there is a rectifier. So when your current from the from a wall socket, let's say 240 volt AC come in, okay, your smartphone charger, the charger inside the charger, that is the first one will be the rectifier. So they rectify, they convert the AC to DC first. But that DC is not at the level, let's say it's not in 5 volt that you want to use to charge your smartphone. So that's the reason after rectifier, okay, we will have the other thing called regulator, voltage regulator or stabilizer. Okay, voltage regulator will regulate, let's say after you convert it's 12 volt, I regulate it to 5 volt because the smartphone only accept 5 volt. Your smartphone input pin for you to connect the smartphone charger, the input pin on your smartphone actually is only accept 5 volt. And then they will, so your smartphone charger, they must output only 5 volt. So after rectifier, they will have another thing called regulator, regulate it to 5 volt. So that 5 volt will be output to your smartphone to charge your smartphone. You understand what I mean? You understand?
Yes.
Yes, sir. So now, okay, we will learn how to create this rectifier. Let's say in your smartphone charger, the first part rectifier using diode. So silicon rectifier diode are widely used in rectifier circuit. In a halfway rectifier, only one alternation of the input waveform is applied to the loop. Okay, when two alternation of the input waveform appear across the loop, it will be called as full wave. So for rectification, there are two types. One is the half wave, the other one is full wave. Half wave means they only allow half of the cycle to go through the to go to the smartphone, for example, to go through the rectifier. Okay, if you use a full wave rectification, you will get a full wave, so full cycle of the AC will be converted to the full cycle of the DC pulsating with DC voltage to the loop. Loop means your smartphone. Okay, you understand what I mean? A loop like your smartphone. Okay, so your smartphone is a loop to get the voltage after you rectify. Okay, so for full wave and half wave, you know already. Full wave, basically, this is a brief. What is the full wave? You know already. So for full wave part, there are many ways to do full wave rectification. Okay, some they use a bridge rectifier, some they just use two diode, some they use four diode. If you use four diode, we call bridge rectifier. If you use two diode, we call full wave, we call diode full wave rectification. Okay, so in experiment objective 2.1, we were going to understand the operation of a simple half wave rectifier. A simple half wave rectifier. So you can see here in this schematic diagram, the smartphone will be here. Okay, look, the smartphone will be there. And then you will have an alternating current 230 volt, or sometimes you put 240 volt also can, no problem. So the voltage come to us on the wall socket in Malaysia is 230 to 240. But in UK, it is not 230 to 240. I think if not mistaken, how much is it? One, how much? It's not 240. Is it 110? I forget. It's 110 or? Yeah, we just refer to the books. The book will use the UK standard. Okay, because yeah. They mentioned not. Just check on it. I think yes.
I Google. They say 230.
230 is not the VNFs for Malaysia, I think. Malaysia is 230 or 240, correct? But UK is not 230.
Yes, because
UK is how much?
230.
Oh, so what Google say 230?
Same socket.
Okay. And because some country is not 230. I forgot where I get the information already. Some country is not 230 or 240. Some country is actually less than that. For example, North America, they actually operate at 110 and 120 to 125. For North America, the voltage actually is 110 to 125 volt. Okay, so this is for North America country. Okay, but for us, we actually our voltage is 230 to 240. Okay, but for other country, they may have 220 volt. So it depends on your country. Okay, so just now your friend found that UK is actually 230, right? 230 volt. Yeah. So you have to follow the standard. You know why we need to know this? Okay, because some of the students, for example, you bought your smartphone charger, right? You bring your smartphone charger to America, North America. Your smartphone charger is based on the input voltage of 240 volt, because your smartphone charger is for Malaysia standards. So if you use your smartphone charger in other countries like North America, which operate at 110 volt, you will have problem to charge your phone. You understand what I mean? Okay, so this is extra knowledge for you. Okay, so this is 2.1, is it? 2.1. Okay, experiment 2. Okay, so this is 230 volt for Malaysia, and then 240 volt also can. Okay, then 50 hertz. 50 hertz means 50 the electron will vibrate 50 times per second. Okay, then you will go through this transformer. Okay, after transformer, you will get the step down voltage. Step down voltage. Have you learned a transformer before? Step up and step down transformer.
Yes.
Yes, So basically, this is a step down. Okay, because the voltage from outside is actually 240 volt. And in the lab, you're going to test the diode, right? Of course, we need to step down the voltage. Okay, we step down the voltage. Okay, and then we use that voltage after step down to test our voltage, to do the rectification by using a single diode for the halfway rectifier. Okay, so I think we stop here first. Okay, we stop at this halfway rectifier. Okay, so I will send you the report format, especially and as well as the assessment criteria. So I will upload to the Google Classroom, and we stop here. For those who want to try it yourself, you can try it, no problem. Experiment two half-wave rectifier, you can try yourself. I will explain further explain what's the use of the transformer and how you set the value for the transformer in this experiment 2.1 for the objective 2.1. Okay, so that's before I end my class. Any question you want to ask? Any question?
Sir, for the transformer, can we replace it with a regulator?
Cannot. Why? Good question. I also wondering last time. Why? Because your regulator only accept
small DC. Voltage.
Oh, DC. Small. Yeah, because your regulator only accept DC. You see here, this one is AC. This one is from outside, you know, from power station. This one AC. So if you use a regulator here, your regulator cannot perform because your regulator only accept DC and then output DC also, but at a different voltage level. It depends on what level you want. So the DC voltage regulator, you can regulate to any voltage level you want. But not let's say your input DC voltage is 12 volt. Okay, I want to output I want to regulate my output DC voltage at 5 volt, 10, no problem. But you cannot do like this, my input voltage is 12 volt DC. I want to output 100 volt DC, cannot. This is not booster. This is not booster. This is not voltage generator. Regulators can regulate down to a level that you want. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. For transformer, okay, before I end my class, I also want to brief you first. For transformer, we actually can step up or step down. But the question is, why we need step up and step down?
So that we don't overload the circuit.
Yes. But actually, the voltage will not overload your circuit. What actually will overload or spoil your circuit? Is the power P equal to IV? Okay, P equal to IV. So you know the transformer step up or step down actually is to change the output voltage, right? If I say step up transformer means that the input voltage will be lower than the output voltage. If I say step down means input voltage will be higher than the output voltage because I step down. Why I change this voltage value? I know you say you want to avoid to overload by your circuit. Yeah, this is correct. But the main reason why we use the transformer here is because we want to deliver the current effectively. Because no matter how you increase the voltage or decrease the voltage, there's one thing never change. Power. Okay, your heat actually is from power. Your heat energy. This is the energy that we don't want. Your heat energy actually is from power. From power. Or we would say it is from. Is from current. Why? Because P equal to IV. Okay, then P equal to IR. P equal to I square R. So if P actually is from current. Okay, in other words, your power is actually in other words, your heat energy actually is from current, you know. So when we have the transformer, we actually want to fix the P1 and the P2 of the transformer. This is a transformer. If this is a from the input, this is from the output, we'll call primary or secondary. Yes, the P actually is stem. So this is IV, this is also IV. So when we increase the V at the output bar, okay, the I will increase. You understand what I mean? Because P is constant, is actually a P at the input bar at the P at the output actually is equivalent. So meaning that this P1 or P primary P, the power is actually fixed. So when I increase the voltage, I use a step up transformer, means I increase the voltage, actually I lower down the current. Why I lower down the current? Because I want to deliver the current to your house. That's why you will see in the power stations from TNB, the Naga National Berhad, they always use a step up, okay, step up transformer to transmit the current. Why step up? They increase the voltage, but they decrease the current during the transmission. When the current reach your house, they will use step down. Why step down? Because they want to decrease the voltage and increase the current. The current is the things that really do your work. So when the current go to your home appliance, then only your appliance can work accordingly. Voltage is just give the potential difference to allow the current to flow. What the thing actually works your home appliance? What is the thing that make your home appliance work is actually the current, not the voltage. Voltage is just like put it there to attract the current to flow in, to function my home appliance. Okay, if you use step up transformer in front of your house, what will happen? Your voltage up, your current down, end up when the current go to your house, your home appliance cannot work. You understand what I mean?
Yes.
Okay, so I will further discuss this during my next practical section. Okay, so no worry. So this is one of the reasons why we use, sometimes you see step up, sometimes why in front of our house, we always use step down. Step down the voltage is because we want to increase the current to function your home appliance. We need current. We need higher current. Okay? When delivery, we don't want current because current will actually be converted to heat energy. So we don't want current. So that's why we step up the voltage to decrease the current so that not much heat energy will be dissipated during the delivery. The second reason of the transformer is because we want an isolation here. When this one something wrong here, they will spoil the circuit here. When they say the high current flow in, they spoil the voltage, spoil the circuit here. They won't spoil your circuit here. The left hand side circuit, if high current flow in, this one will be spoiled. The right hand side will not be spoiled because the transformer is not connected. The transformer has a gate in between. So this is to protect your second circuit, which is at the secondary part. Isolation. We isolate your main circuit from the external circuit. You understand what I mean? This is the second reason why we use transformer. Okay?
Yes, I understand.
Okay, that's it for today. So I will try to upload the Google how I install the multi sim to the Google Classroom. So that's it for today. So any question you want to ask?
No.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.